sometimes people ask me, you know, how do I feel about black holes? Do you find them scary, intimidating? Well, they are a bit, but they can be cuddly too. These are two cuddly toy black holes that I got as a present from my sister-in-law. I just like them. They're just little cuddly things. There's a little baby one, and there's a slightly bigger, you know, mummy black hole, if you like.
Oh, well, a black hole is a region of space in which light can't escape from.
Material comes together under the force of gravity, tries to fight that, but if you get too much material, you can't overcome that force. And eventually, mathematics and the laws of physics take us into this strange regime.
Well, it's an object which forms when a star dies.
Something that's got many masses of the sun has collapsed under its own gravitational pull.
We've got a lot of mass packed in a very small region.
Eventually it collapses to the point where not even light can escape from it, and it forms something called an event horizon.
But it's like a shell, if you like. And that event horizon is the... Within that event horizon, light can't escape. So that's why it's black.
At the centre, it has this mathematical impossibility called a singularity.
So they say black holes can't have hair. Well, these ones do. And eyes.
Do you know what I like? To make the Earth into a black hole, you'd actually have to make it about that size.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so if that was really a black hole, it would be probably more massive than the Earth, contained within that little tiny region.
Here on Earth, if you throw something up in the air, it comes back down again. Okay, and if you throw it a bit harder, it goes a bit higher, but it will tend to come back down again. If you throw something hard enough, it'll actually escape from the Earth entirely. A rocket. It doesn't have to be. I mean, you know, you could fire a projectile up or anything. As long as it's travelling at this escape velocity, escape speed, it will escape from the Earth's gravity, keep going and going and going off to infinity, rather than eventually turning around and coming back. If you were to make the Earth a bit more compressed, then the gravitational pull would get a bit more intense. And so actually you'd have to throw something a bit harder to get it to escape from the Earth's pull of gravity. If you kept squishing the Earth, eventually you'd reach a point where the gravitational pull was so strong that that escape velocity became equal to the speed of light. And because we can't get anything to go at the speed of light, apart from light, and in particular, we definitely can't get anything to go faster than light, that means if you then squish it a tiny bit more, then nothing can escape. Not even light can escape. Nothing can escape from it, because suddenly, in order to escape from it, you'd have to make something travel faster than light in order to do so.
But a black hole in general relativity is actually even more sinister than that. It's not just that light can't escape. A black hole in GR, there is literally no way to get out of it. If it was just a matter of the escape velocity being high, you could always build a ladder, climb out of it, and with a sufficiently powerful rocket, get away. But there's actually more to it than that. Space and time collapses in on itself as you enter the event horizon of a black hole in GR, and there's literally no way to escape from it.
Now, we all know black holes involve these things called singularities. But from what you're saying, it sounds like you don't have to get as far as a singularity to get to a point where light can't escape. It could be quite a lot bigger than a singularity.
Indeed, and in fact, so these the kind of the thought experiment I've just gone through predates general relativity by a long time. I think probably Laplace or someone was the first person who actually thought this through and realised there was a point where you would create a thing called a black hole. And if just dealing with Newtonian gravity, you still have a black, you know, you can create black holes. It's only when you then say, okay, so what, when you try and solve the set of equations as to what's going on within general relativity, when you've gone through this process, that's when you realise that you actually create a singularity by doing that.
In GR, space and time becomes compressed such that any movement you make in time or space takes you towards the centre of the thing. And actually that's what led Hawking and Penrose in the late 60s to suggest that you have to have a singularity at the centre of a black hole, essentially.
And then eventually your equations inevitably break down. And so you have to, the very existence of black holes and the singularity that you looks like you have at the centre of them tells you that Einstein's theory is not a complete theory. It's at best an effective theory, that it needs to be replaced by something else when you start talking about, you know, high energies, strong gravitational fields, and so on and so forth.
Even when you get to photons, things with no mass at all, they still get pulled by gravity. And we can see that directly through this phenomenon called gravitational lensing, that where you've got like light from something passing a massive body, probably a galaxy or something like that, you can actually see that the path of light has been bent by gravity. And so actually gravity is affecting even light. Its path is being diverted by it, so it's being pulled by the gravitational field. So even light's not immune to gravity. Now, the thing that's different is that light doesn't slow down, because light always travels at the speed of light. So if you think about, you know, you're on one of these incredibly compact objects and you're shining a light upwards and saying, what happens? It's not like throwing a rock in the air that it comes back down again. With light, it will keep traveling away from you at the speed of light. But it's using up energy, right? The, another way to think about these things is the energy that you're turning the kinetic energy of something, if it's a rock, into its potential energy as it goes away from the surface. It's the same with light, but the way that light loses its energy isn't by slowing down. The way that light loses its energy is by changing color. It would lose its energy by changing color by, you know, starting at the blue end of the spectrum and ending up at the red end of the spectrum, and then beyond red, it would turn into infrared, radio waves. And actually, before it escaped, it would have used up all its energy and kind of redshifted to nothingness. There would be no energy left to escape.
So little lone black holes, which we call stellar mass black holes, can be one of the several endpoints to the evolution of a star. They are by no means the most common endpoint. So most stars, like our own sun, will turn into a white dwarf at the end of their life and then fade into basically nothingness. If you have a star that's massive enough, and the mass of the star governs pretty much its entire life, it will either turn into a neutron star through a supernova, or if it's even more massive, it'll turn into an even denser object, which is the black hole. And so, you know, there are a lot of stars out there, so there are a lot of black holes out there, but they're by no means sort of ubiquitous and littering the galaxy.
We know there's always gravity, so there's always something pulling things together. So the sort of the, sometimes the more salient question is, what stops everything collapsing into black holes? And so, for example, in something like the sun, you've got the nuclear fusion in the middle, which is producing the energy, which is heating things up, which is kind of keeping it puffed up. But if you were to turn off that nuclear fusion, then the sun would start to collapse down. And gravity would pull it and pull it and pull it, and then you say, okay, so what else could stop it? I've no longer got my source of fusion. And it turns out there are a few things that might help out. So there's this thing called electron degeneracy pressure, which is a very... electrons basically don't like being squashed close together. And so electron degeneracy pressure will stop something like the sun from collapsing all the way to a black hole. It'll turn it into a thing called a white dwarf, which is held up by electron degeneracy pressure. Turns out if it was a bit more massive, then even electron degeneracy pressure wouldn't do it. Gravity would win again. So it would say, to hell with this, squash all the electrons together. And then it would collapse down further to kind of nuclear density. At that point, you create a thing called a neutron star. And there's a thing called neutron degeneracy pressure, which is that neutrons don't like being squashed very close together either. And so that will halt the collapse and you'll end up with a neutron star. But then it's if a little bit more massive than that, so maybe about twice the mass of the sun, a bit more than that, then even the neutron degeneracy pressure won't stop it, and then it'll keep collapsing. And then as far as we know, there's nothing that will stop that collapse. Now, maybe we're missing some physics, maybe there is some process we don't know about which would actually halt that collapse, but we don't know what it is. But they're the boring ones. Let me tell you about the interesting ones. The interesting ones are the ones that live in the middle of galaxies, which are enormous. They're very, very massive.
Indeed, and so that process goes on as well. And in fact, when we see these incredibly bright things in quite
the world across the
global symmetry,
we can actually, in some respect, track of this.
We've actually seen